I know. It's been several months since I've done anything on the YouTube channel. However, if you want to know what I've been doing in my time off, you can kind of see some of the pictures behind me. I've been building up some radio control cars, getting back into a hobby that I haven't done in 20-something years. It's been really good. And if you're interested, leave me a comment below and I'll maybe put some of the content up. Kyosho Inferno and some other bits and pieces, all really good. Anyway, I am back, baby, and I'm gonna be better than ever. And there's gonna be this video and some other videos and lots of other ideas going forwards. So stay tuned for loads more content. So welcome back to the channel. I've been putting a lot of effort into this particular lock recently, and I wanted to do a very, very quick update video because since I did my last video on this lock, the link is somewhere up here or down below, the Proxmark client has updated and there's been a bit of a change around sectors and blocks. And so therefore the instructions I gave you last time actually don't work if you're using the absolute latest version of the Iceman build. Now this particular debugging that I'm about to do and about to show you also works if you debug in kind of any unknown RFID system of any description. So this is not just specific to a Yale lock, but actually could be used with anything where there's a My Fair Classic card involved. And essentially what we're showing here is every time you use this lock to actuate, or this card, sorry, to actuate the lock, the Yale lock here actually writes a unique value to block 5 of the card. And if you want to, say for example, if you copy this card onto this card using your iCopyX or using your Proxmark, whatever you want to use really, once you've copied the card onto the other card, only one card will work. And I demonstrated that in the previous video. So essentially, you can only get one card working at any one particular time. And in a future video, I think I can just change the ID number on the card and then bind with the app another card with a slightly different ID number, and I think we'll be fine. But that's not the point I'm getting to here. The point I'm getting to here is every time you use the card in the lock, it puts another value on that the lock expects to find. So for example, if I copy this card onto this card and then utilize this card, suddenly this card doesn't work because it won't have the right value on there. Now I can prove this by actually looking at the block that changes, and I'll show you how to see which bit changes on the card. And then actually copy that block back onto the other card and demonstrate it's working. So without copying this card onto this card, now I've already copied this card from this card last night for some other reason, and if I try and make this work, it won't work as you can hear. It says, sorry, invalid card. Whereas if I do it with this card, you can see, there we are, it actually works. That is, that's the symbol for it working. And as I did that, as I put this card onto here, it rewrote a unique value onto block number 5. Now, how do I know that? Well, I'm about to show you why I know that. So let's do a very, very quick demonstration and let's jump down onto the computer screen. Really standard setup here. I've just got my Proxmark disconnected. You've seen this 1,000 times. I'm not gonna go through this. And I've got the original Yale card just sitting down on here. And if I do an HF search, you can just see, there we are, original My Fair Classic 1K. Now, one of the really interesting things, if I just do an HF MF auto, it's a 1K card, so I don't need to specify it as a 4 because HFM Auto, the default is 1K. Just press enter. This will go and do its fancy thing. And it's found some keys. It'll just try a few times. There we are. It's finding some keys.
A few moments later.
So now that's finally finished. So we can see on the screen the different sectors and the keys on the key A and key B and various other things. I won't go into that, but it says it's created four files. It's created a key bin. That's where your where the keys are all stored. It's created a dump, a binary file of the dump, which is really, really great, so that if I want to copy that onto something else, I've got a dump. It's created an EML file, which is a text file, which is very, very useful. It contains all of the information about how the card is laid out, and there's a script in the scripts directory, which you can actually use to transfer the EML file into HTML. And it's also created a JSON file, which is actually what we're going to use now. Now, these files will always be created in whatever directory you started the Proxmark 3 command in. Not where the command binaries are, but where you started, wherever your present working directory was when you started. So if I jump over here, you can see I created a directory called YouTube, and if I do an ls in there, you'll see those particular files that I just referred to. So if I do this one more time, I take this particular this key, if I lock it again, oh no, we're on the wrong side. Oh no, it actually is locked. Right, so if I unlock the lock, there we are, that's now unlocked. If I now put my card back on the Proxmark, jump back over here again, and just redo the auto again, it should just be able to zip straight through really, really quickly because it doesn't actually do any cracking this time. And it should be really, really quick. There we are. Boom. There we are. Right. And if I do an ls minus l again, you'll see it's created dump-1 and dump-json. Now, if I do a diff and I put in two files, if I put in the hfmf and then the dump.json as my first file, and if I put in the dump.json1 as my second file, you'll see that only number 4 has changed. Now, I'll be honest with you, sometimes number 4 changes, sometimes number 5 changes. Mainly it's number 4. But now I know if I take the block 4 from this card, which is, if I do a less on the file number 1, and if I, and block 4 is this one here, if I copy that text there, and if I copy that from this card and put it onto this card, guess what? This card that it claims will not work. If I just try it, and it doesn't work. If I now copy that text onto here, it will work. So let's put this onto here. Let's just find my command. Let's just go back into my Proxmark and just get my data and my Proxmark. There we are. Right, and if I get my data from over here, which was that data there, I think it's that one, dot one, it starts BEEFO6 on 4, yeah, that's the one. And if I wipe out this data here and put in that data there, that should now work. And now, moment of truth, does this work? The lock is locked. Behold, it now works. Because essentially all the lock is doing is just changing that one thing. So now if I try this card, this shouldn't work. Exactly. The important part about this video is not just to give a recap on the lock and give a recap on the commands and how they've changed and how they now look, but to really demonstrate to you that if you actually generate that JSON file with all of the information from each of the sections and blocks on the card, and then just do a simple diff command, you can really, really quickly start to work out where the card is starting to change things. Now, why is this useful? Well, imagine, for example, you're trying to play with a payment system. Well, you can essentially dump the card, put some money on the card or take some money off the card, do some operation with the card, dump the card again. Do something else with the card, dump the card again. And then essentially you can then just diff each one of the ones and say, okay, so whenever I make a financial transaction, it's only that block that's changing in this particular way. And rather swiftly, you'll probably be able to work out where it's storing the money, where the check bit is and whatever else. But anyway, that's it for today. I hope this has been a really, really quick sort of useful little video just showing you just how you can actually use really, really basic features of the Proxmark and a bit of diff just to work out what's going on different sectors of the card. And obviously this video isn't meant for the really advanced users, but it's meant for users like you and me, people who know what they're kind of doing, but if you're trying to do some debugging to work out what a particular system's doing, well, maybe you need a bit more help. Anyway, until next time, stay safe, don't hack anything you shouldn't, and keep exploring.